more do we have?
I'm sure we have next week, right?
We have at least two more.
We have at least two more.
We've got Dorothea and Elsa Jane, and I did teach to skip last week.
Okay, well, we have about three more weeks then, it sounds like to me. And I want to remind you all about things coming up.
Yeah.
Good Friday will be coming up.
How much is it gonna be this year?
$50 this year.
$50.
And there's a little bit of a change I want to prepare you for, and that is you have to pay in advance.
Well, that was last year too.
Well, people were there to take money last year, and this year we're saying you have to pay in advance to come in because we have limited seating. And so get signed up. You have a month to sign up. It's April 7th is Good Friday this year. And
can you not sign up before you pay?
You can sign up, but it would be you have to pay before the event. That's the whole thing.
That's what I was thinking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you can mail a check in. You can pay cash, or you can pay online. However you want to do it. The problem this year is that they're doing things a little bit different at Celebrate Catering, and they're kind of putting a few more demands on. Things have gotten a little more expensive since COVID and since inflation. So just preparing you.
But that, it will be at the same place?
Yeah, same place, Celebrate Catering. It's over on Bangy Road, and we'll have cards out. We're sending postcards out. We're going to have advertisements online. But it's only a month away, so I really wanted to prepare you to come. And it's going to be special. It'll be a really good event. So I want you to be sure to plan for our Good Friday event. Very, very important. What other announcements we have? We have some really neat things coming up this summer. Maja Delouche from Israel will be here for a month. Mm-hmm. He's bringing his son to teach him about the ministry. We'll have Anwar here with her brother Mohammed. Abraham will be here with Anwar. They'll be here for 2 weeks from Palestine. They're running our daycare project. Used to be Rose of Jerusalem. We're still calling it that, but it's a daycare project for moms, and it's a really important and significant work we do in the West Bank. Pray for the West Bank. They're having all kinds of violence, and things are not going well there. People are living in a lot of fear, a lot of terror right now, and it's an important time of praying over Israel, over Palestine, over all the violence in that land. Boy, what a good-looking group of people. It's so good to see you. To see you all. Matisse, I'm used to you being here. I see you online now. It's nice to see you.
Thank you. We're having a night, so.
Oh, lucky you. You look so cute, though.
Our prayers are with you.
Our prayers are with you, yes, very much so. Yep, and Scott, good to see you. Lila. Nice to see you online. We got Kelly Chang and Lorna. Mark Weisogel, and I bet you have a friend there with you. Lee Weisogel, so nice to see you, sir. I'm so glad you could do Wednesday night and do Bible study. And it's great, just great. Dorothea's here from all the way over in Vancouver. I'm so glad to see you. Are you teaching next week, Dorothea? Next week will be Dorothea. That'll be significant and really good. All the teachings have been good. Everybody's done a really great job. Hannah, nice to see you. Welcome. And Elsa Jane finally shows up. So happy to see you. Yeah, yeah. And so tonight we are going to have the pleasure of listening to Tina McGanty, and I don't know if you were here last year when she taught, but I watched that, and she's just a tremendous teacher, and we're very fortunate to have her here. Do you have somebody with you that you want to introduce, Tina?
I have two people.
Okay.
And Crystal Johnson.
Crystal Johnson's here.
One of my best buds and roommates. And Kelly Chang, another one of my best buds and roommates.
Great. We're so glad. Kelly, welcome. Yeah, I thought I saw that name online.
Thank you, Kelly.
Yeah. So this is an important night for us to have a really good teaching. Lance was supposed to be here tonight. He could not make it. He got called out of town. So he won't be coming tonight. I'm sorry about that. Other than Good Friday, it seems like I have another announcement to make. What is it?
Intensive training.
Intensive training's coming up, and that's in
April
21st through 23rd. Everyone's invited to come to intensive. And we are having some people. We have some people requesting housing from Walla Walla. Does anybody think you have an extra room or a little bit of space to have a few people stay at your home during intensive that weekend? It would be really helpful. I don't know how many people we're going to have yet, but there's a group that wants to come over from Walla Walla Center, and they would like, they're going to need housing. So if you have housing, let us know. Let us know how much housing you have. And it's always fun to put people up and get to visit. April 21st through 23rd is the intensive.
Yeah.
Yeah. So let us know if you have space, and we'll let you know how many people are coming. And it's, gosh, there is another announcement I am missing, and my poor brain is not accessing.
It's that tea, I think.
Oh, fashion show. Sorry. Thank you for reminding me. Fashion show and tea is this Saturday, coming up at 10 o'clock at Lake Bible. The cost is $25 a ticket, and that's a special time for everybody. We really enjoy that every year. It's the Uganda Satellite. They do it every year, and it's to raise money for the Uganda school. And so it's a significant event, but it's fun. They have generally have finger foods and tea, and then we have a fashion show. And the clothes that they're showing are from the thrift store. And
what time is it?
10 o'clock in the morning at Lake Bible, which is right out in Lake Oswego off of Cruise Way. So this is, I hope y'all come. And maybe even a few of us girls can carpool, because it'll be a really fun morning to enjoy. So plan on coming. $25, just not very much. It's really a great every year event. So please don't miss it if you don't have to. And if you need help getting there, let us know.
And the first time I went to Good Friday was $4.
The first time you went to, well, the first time you went to Good Friday was $4. Where was it at?
It's a restaurant that's no longer there.
A restaurant that's no longer there.
It's Chinese food.
Mm-hmm. Well, there were cheaper places we could have gone, like Chinese food, but we've kind of grown to the place where we have over 100 people who come to this event, and so finding a good enough venue that does good food, and you're not going to get much anymore renting a building and stuff for under $50. So keep that in mind. We are going to have our annual banquet this year, and our theme this year is something worth saving. Something worth saving is our theme for the year, and that's going to be kind of what we talk about in our family camp. Family camp this year is going to be an important time as well. Didn't bring my dates in. Do you have them? We'll be advertising them too. The reason I mentioned family camp this early in the year when it's going on in October is because you got to save money.
Yeah.
I'm not sure we're going to have the scholarships we've always had. I hope we do, but I can't promise that we will. So the family camp costs have gone up as well. I think they're around $175.
Jeez.
But I'm
October
not.
October
6th to 8th. Well, you have almost a year. I mean, you have a long time to start putting money away.
And that's per person. Per person.
Yeah, it may not. I need to get all those things, all the costs. that have still not been quite settled yet. So when I hear how much it actually is, I'll let you know. But just
175 per person.
It may or may not be. It may or may not be that much.
Maybe you.
I will let you.
Let's go shipping for.
Or maybe you can start putting $25 a month away for it.
There you go.
Because by then you'd have the whole amount, right?
That's smart.
Think about it. Save your money. This is how we do stuff.
Instead of my...
It's a good discipline to save your money for family camp.
Instead of my tidying to you?
And one of the other things that would be helpful is maybe you'd save so much money you'd help somebody else. And we can create another scholarship for more people. That's nice, too. So think about ways of helping others. That's the Samaritan way, actually.
Okay.
All right, Tina, I'm just going to turn you loose because it's...
I can go home?
No, turn you loose to teach.
I'm joking.
Not to go home.
I'm joking.
We will drag you back in the room and make you talk.
Right?
Anyway, let's welcome Tina, and it's great to have you. Yay, Tina. You go, girl.
Thanks.
So if the computer's here, where do I set my stuff at? My Bible and my...
Yes. What I can do is... Just to make sure your hat's on.
What's that? Roll stuff?
Okay. I can move this bit to there, yeah.
Well, I like my paper up on the podium, and I do
like to see the computer as well.
Oh, that's low.
Oh, my head came on.
Yeah, dude.
I think it's working.
Oh, I heard that it was supposed to be on the podium, so...
Uh-oh.
Oh, tip, Paul. Oh, there you go.
Stand by the post. Thank you for your flexibility and patience.
Who's that? Lee Weisbach.
Well, it's kind of a loose pocket pants thing going on.
There we go.
Yeah, we don't want to give them too much TMI stuff. Okay, what are you doing?
Okay, now we're good. We're just going to drive my home back.
Okay. Deep breath.
There we go.
So you're going to have to teach us about this volume stuff.
And this is still the same as normal, like looking at a camera or a regular laptop. I can look at the top of the laptop to look at people online.
It's going to be this one.
Right oh, here. Right yeah. There.
Okay. I see you guys.
And I'd like to welcome everybody and everybody here, everybody online. Oh, yeah, that camera. And I would really like to pray and just welcome the Holy Spirit into this room and this atmosphere.
I've been enjoying your pictures.
Into our hearts. What's that, Kathy?
I said I'm enjoying your pictures.
My pictures?
On Facebook.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we'll talk about that after class. So, but thank you. Most of all, I just want to turn our focus onto our Lord Jesus Christ, who gives us the strength, power and authority to speak in his name, God. And God, we welcome that. We welcome all that you are, all of your, everything that you are. You're just so big, and we can't live life without that. And we thank you that you help us through each day and that you have spoken to each of these teachers and spoken to every teacher that we have heard, God. We have gleaned so much from your Holy Spirit, Lord. And I know that I have in the preparation of this teaching. We both know, God, it's been a unique journey and a treacherous one, but one that I am thankful for because I get the opportunity to speak your words through your Holy Spirit tonight. And so I speak against anything that should not be present in my body and in the body of Christ, and just to fill us up, God, with your love and your peace and your grace that we're going to read about tonight. Amen.
Amen.
So, everybody's heard, I just feel like sometimes I'm cutting in and out. I don't know if that's true or not, but I just don't want that to be consistent during the time that we're going to be receiving here. I don't know who all have seen the schedule of the subjects we're going to be teaching on, but the subject I'm going to be teaching on isn't really a subject. It's
a person.
And we all like to talk about our favorite influential people in our lives. And this one really stuck out to me because we all know this person if we've read the New Testament at all, especially the epistles, which are the letters to all of the churches from Paul. And he had gone through so much, which we are going to speak about. But so many changes in life, I mean, so many changes, including the change of seasons that we're in right now. We're all tired of winter, right? We're all talking about the snow, the rain, the sleet, everything. And so we're
in winter right now.
But the seasons just have, there's so many different characteristics
and complexities of
even their change
of that. So yeah, spring, summer, winter, fall,
and that's all a change. And even the vividness of each one and the change from childhood to adolescence to adulthood. And even that with the transitions from each of those phases is such a change. Even for a young child, and they see changes going on at home and the holidays and such. And jobs, moving from one job to the next and getting your first job or moving to an unknown place. And all of us can, probably in this room and online, can relate to all of that. We're going to talk about a man who encountered such a pivotal change in his life that there was no going back on this one at all. This man is the Apostle Paul, who would encounter change after change after change, as we all do. His changes, though, through life were complex to endure, much hardships and persecution from all directions, every which way. Paul was a man of great knowledge and knew the law extremely well, which gave him such advantage in acquiring much power. The ways that he used the power in his early days before his conversion, when he went by Saul, was so overwhelming that his solid reputation was more than a reputation, but a lifestyle of much persecution. He was the one persecuting. And later the tables will be flipped with that. But here's the illustration taken from scripture from this encounter, followed by the assignment, which is found in Acts 9, verse 4. And I was going to bring my water bottle up here, and it looks like I forgot that. And thank you very much, Crystal. So I'm going to take a drink, and you all are going to turn to that. Acts 9, chapter 9, verse 4. And I'll go ahead and turn to it, too. We'll we'll start with that one verse, and then we're going to read about the whole conversion. I'm just setting the stage here. Okay, verse 4. So suddenly, while he was traveling to Damascus, and just before he reached the city, there came a light from heaven all around him. He fell to the ground, and then he heard a voice saying, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?
Are you in chapter 4?
I am in chapter 9.
Sorry, thank you.
And that was verse 4. So the 4 was verse 4. Do you need me to read that again so you can follow along, or are you cool?
I'm cool. I heard you.
Okay. So you suddenly fall to the ground from being, whoa, by this big bright light, and these lights up here are definitely not doing that to us. But as he was down there, he was probably like in shock, what's going on? So let's read just the whole thing to see what he really kind of experienced, to give us the experience to kind of see what he went through. So we're going to read that again, but we're going to start and read through 1 through 19, and I can do this with Christ. Okay. So meanwhile, Saul was still breathing threats to slaughter the Lord's disciples. He had gone to the high priest and asked for letters to address the synagogues in Damascus that would authorize him to arrest and take to Jerusalem any followers of the way, men or women, that he could find. And here we go. Suddenly, while he was traveling to Damascus, and just before he reached the city, there came a light from heaven all around him. He fell to the ground. Then he heard a voice saying, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Who are you, Lord? He asked. And the voice answered, I am Jesus, and you are persecuting me. Get up now and go to the city, and you will be told what you have to do. The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless, for though they heard the voice, they could see no one. Saul got up from the ground, but even with his eyes wide open, he could see nothing at all, and they had to lead him into Damascus by the hand. For 3 days he was without sight and took neither food nor drink. A disciple called Ananias, who lived in Damascus, had a vision in which he heard the Lord say to him, Ananias, when he replied, Here I am, Lord. The Lord said, You must go to Straight Street and ask at the house of Judas for someone called Saul, who comes from Tarsus. At this moment he is having a vision of a man called Ananias coming in and laying hands on him to give him back his sight. When he heard that, Ananias said, Lord, several people have told me about this man and all the harm he has been doing to your saints in Jerusalem. He has only come here because he holds a warrant from the chief priests to arrest everybody that invokes your name. The Lord replied, You must go all the same, because this man is my chosen instrument to bring my name before pagans and pagan kings and before the people of Israel. I myself will show him how much he himself must suffer my name. Then Ananias went. He entered the house, and at once he laid hands on Saul and said, Brother Saul, I have been sent by the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the way here so that you may recover your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately, it was as though scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he could see again. So he was baptized there and then, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. Now, isn't that a miracle? After I read that in my preparation time and, you know, the scripture, I mean, I'd read it over and over to practice, and I remember doing, I don't know if it was the same thing, but I remember doing a miracle healing, and I'm not sure if it's Cindy or not, but it's very impactful. I just try to imagine yourself as all this happening, and I can't. I mean, I try to just imagine living a life that you're used to living, going about your day, getting knocked off your horse or whatever you were riding with this light. I know that my eyes are sensitive to bright light. When I see fireworks just flash really bright, it hurts. I'm sure this is 10, 20 times worse. Yeah, I just can't imagine. And so after living that life, he was so used to carrying out assignments that were assigned to him from this point of authority. It's like his whole life changed in an instant. And this was such a life of what we call familiarity. I can't really say that word very well, but which is, we will revisit that again, familiarity. He currently, being unable to see, took on the assignment after he made some significant decisions, one of which being baptized. I don't know if, you know, you guys had your conversion experience or coming to the Lord, being saved, going, whoa, now I really want to do all I want to do with the Lord, because you know you're chosen, because you chose to be saved from, you know, your encounter with the Holy Spirit. And that's what Saul/Paul decided to do, because he wanted to live and serve the Lord. So he's made some instant decisions, some instant healing, as we were all talking about other Bible studies. So here's another example of that. So from here, he not only regained his sight, but his spirit saw the truth of God immediately, and he began proclaiming that Jesus is the Son of God. And it says that in verse 20. So to me, this is very dramatic and amazing of what God can do in choosing one person to spread his word and truth from someone who spent a lifetime and a lifestyle of such corruption toward others, and God trusted him. God trusted him, and he knew who Saul was. And, you know, I'm going to say probably throughout this whole teaching, it just blows my mind. I can't even wrap my head around it. So each of the churches that he had a heart for, he was led to God to go through a few and speak to some. And, excuse me here. That comes later, actually. So we'll do this first. So yeah, it's extremely mind-blowing, and I know that indeed in my life, I'm like, God will show me something, and I'm like, no way, and it blows my mind. And we all have little conversion spirit instances or circumstances, revelations or aha moments. And you know, I actually had some today in counseling. I'm like, wow, you know. So it's like, thank you, Holy Spirit. And I'm sure Paul was saying that, and he couldn't wait and wanted to go proclaim after being baptized. But you know, it does say that, but also it says in Galatians 1, verses 17 and 18. So keep in mind that he was so excited and on fire for the Lord after his conversion. Yes, he did want to proclaim. But keep in mind also that when we are given assignments, is it really wise to just go? So let me turn to Galatians as well, and I'll let you know when I'm ready. Because I feel this is important. Verse 17. Then God, who had specially chosen me, this is him talking to the church of Galatia, while I was still in my mother's womb, called me through his grace and chose to reveal his son in me so that I might preach the good news about him to the pagans. I did not stop to discuss this with any human being, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to see those who were already apostles before me. But I went off to Arabia at once and later went straight back from there to Damascus. Even when after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem to visit Cephas and stayed with him for 15 days. I did not see any of the other apostles. I only saw James, the brother of the Lord. And I swear before God that I have just written this little truth. After that, I went to Syria and Sicilia, and I was still known by sight to the churches of Jesus Christ in Judea, who had heard nothing except that their one-time persecutor was now preaching the faith he had previously tried to destroy, and they gave glory to God for me. It's amazing. So, I want to talk about, this is just an example of Paul not taking this assignment lightly. You know, when we're chosen, you know, we're all chosen. And when we take an assignment, you know, we're taught, especially by the influence of Betty, we're not to take assignments lightly. So he went to God about it. He went clearly to Arabia, and he did not hesitate on this. So this is an example for us, is when we are given an assignment, we are called somewhere. I mean, I'm in my room most of the time on my bed and just listening, and I was preparing this, you know, in the quiet of my room. So he actually went farther than, you know, I do with my bedroom. He went to Arabia, and he sat in solitude with the Lord. We don't know what he did there. But he went there for 3 years, and there must have been, you know, much training, much mentorship from the Holy Spirit, and most of all, listening to God. And that's what we're called to do before any important decision. I have really faltered in that area in my life in a lot of different ways. I won't go into them because I don't want to spill my whole guts here in a Bible study, but we learn from those, and it strengthens us along the way. And then we go to God for repentance. But maybe some or a bunch of inner healing had to take place to have much proclamation take place to speak the word of God. I mean, that helps. You know, this is so different. I'm so off track, and I'm sorry, but a lot of you know I'm a Green Bay Packers fan, and there's the quarterback who's just like, oh, I'm going to go in this dark place, this dark hole, to go contemplate my future. Well, it's like, well, yeah, go do that, but, you know, I find it better to go seek the Lord Jesus Christ and friends that seek the Lord as well. So that's what I think we are to be influenced by from Paul's example during the time here. So this isn't really the time in my teaching. I'm just called by the Holy Spirit right now. This has been going on for, you know, a few minutes already. Does anybody have any reactions to this? We've talked about some pretty big stuff. online or in person. And just don't ever raise finger guns. Come on.
Yeah. How can happen attitude change?
Yeah.
Overnight.
Yeah.
And goals changed overnight.
Right, right. So Kathy's going to speak into the mic. Why don't you say that again, please?
Yeah, how has attitude changed? It has goals changed literally overnight.
Yeah.
3 days that he was blind, and then it actually was 3 days, right?
Yes, yes. For 3 days he was blind. It says no food or drink. So he basically went on a fast. And I don't know, I don't recall, anybody can reach out, but or why he did that. He was probably called by the Holy Spirit to do it. Gosh, it just proves that the Holy Spirit is just so powerful. You know, I don't think about that every day. I do, because I get through each day by the grace of God from the Holy Spirit. But anyone else before we go on? All right, but some of Paul's back history is that he was a well-known Pharisee who knew the Jewish law very well and whose job was literally to persecute on a regular basis. Saul knew his job, and he knew it well, having much familiarity of it. Now, do you think Saul, would want to give up this lifestyle back then? Oh, yeah, I go to work every day. I see my clients. Many of you know I'm a job coach, and it's my lifestyle. I'm comfortable with it. I really am, even though it is hard to get out of bed. I do get out of bed because of the grace of God, but I'm thankful that I do, because it is my familiarity, it is my comfort. And if someone told me not to do it, I was like, well, what the heck is your problem? So that's maybe, you know, he was used to that familiarity, but then Kathy said his whole attitude changed. So I don't think any of that might have mattered, because his assignment was to spread the word of God from, you know, the Jesus Christ within him, which, yeah, like we said, is amazing. So yeah, familiarity. He was a man of great intelligence and knew how to strategize well on a regular basis. He had a full life of familiarity, even as far back as childhood and youth. Paul learned how to work with his hands. All his life, I think he just grew up working and learned how to build tents in his early years, and he went off of that. And so there's proof of that in 1 Corinthians 4, verse 12. We will read it, but this trade of tent making, which he continued to practice after his conversion to Christianity, helps us to explain important aspects of his apostleship, because he could travel with a few leather working tools and set up shop anywhere. And it says that, I would actually like to read that verse, 1 Corinthians 4, verse 12, and I'm going to turn to it. Here we go. To this day, we go without food and drink. Here we go again, without food or drink. I couldn't do that. And clothes, we are beaten and have no homes. We work for our living with our own hands. When we are cursed, we answer with a blessing. When we are hounded, we put up with it. We are insulted and we answer politely. We are treated as the offal of the world, still to this day, the scum of the earth. So that's really encouraging. Yeah, right? So, but the encouraging thing is, I think, is because that familiarity with, okay, I've got this to go off of with my tent making. I have the word of the Lord within me, and that's becoming his new familiarity. So, as I'm going to talk about more in this teaching, that it can either work for or against us. And it mentions his trait a few times in the Bible, again in Acts 18, verses 1 through 4. And I know a trait or a job doesn't define us, but it's not, you know, it's not our identity. But what I'm trying to say here is that he knew his assignment, and to do his assignment, some of the things that he knew already with his experience would help him with it. So let's turn to Acts 18, verses 1 through 4. Okay, 18, verses 1 through 4.
Acts?
Yes, Acts 18, 1 through 4. Here we go. After this, Paul left Athens and went to Corinth, where he met a Jew called Aquila, whose family came from Pontus. He and his wife Priscilla had recently left Italy because an edict of Claudius had expelled all the Jews from Rome. Paul went to visit them, and when he found they were tent makers of the same trade as himself, he lodged with them, and they worked together. Every Sabbath he used to hold debates in the synagogue, trying to convert Jews as well as Greeks. So again, that's encouraging, because, you know, I'm talking about a lot of trade and work and things like that, just to illustrate where we're at with the apostleship of Paul. And I can relate to that a little bit. I'm not a tent maker, but, you know, with my job as being a job coach, I run into other job coaches out in the community or a training. And a training that I was at recently, I was sitting down waiting in the lobby for, you know, the training to begin. And I ran into this other job coach or, you know, just the whole job title is probably community employment specialist. I'm not going to say that, but I'm just saying job coach. So anyways, her and I were connecting and we had the same trade. And we could relate with that. And so Paul ran into these people who were tent makers. I'm like, oh, great, let's relate and make tents together maybe. And then he's like, okay, I'm even more encouraged, and I'm just going to start preaching here. So let's see where we're at. So the ministry could flourish this way because of that encouragement and because he had that tool belt with him to set up shop anywhere. And this was his means of provision and for gatherings to hear Paul preach and proclaim the goodness of God and the word of God. So he had a lot going for him, actually. And so the spirit of, again, the spirit of familiarity can work both for and against us, depending on how we use it. In his case, he used it before his conversion with much persecution, in the way he lived and conducted life under the leadership and authority. After his conversion, though, he used what he was good at from God as building tents to work with it and for God and not against him. Do you see that comparison, that parallelism? Do you guys want to add to that at all? Go for it. Remember, we're all teachers. And then another question I have here is, does any of this sound familiar in your life? Any life-changing ways of conversion that, and then any gifts from your conversion that you have used in your own personal ministry in your own life? So I'd like to open it up to the class right now with that question.
This is Matisse. I know this is kind of it's a funny thing to say, but can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. I think it's a funny thing to say, but I feel like my experience in sales has helped me be a greeter at church, because I know and understand how to make someone comfortable and greet them. And I think that it's something I definitely feel like God has used as a skill, just to welcome people. I know that sounds funny to say, but I do think that there's something in that, right? And I think that you know, I waited tables for a long time, and I think it was the same thing. It's a crossover skill, and mm-hmm. I think it works in the kingdom of God too.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
Yeah, yeah. Teresa says that's good, and I kind of want to respond to that as well, Matisse, to add just a little bit to that, because with Paul's history that we just spoke about earlier, as I explained, with his strategic thinking, his problem-solving skills, and just his knowledge and his wit of things, of how to figure things out, and his relational skills, and with you speaking of your relational skills with sales and greeting, and he was kind of that way, so then he just got the opportunity and took it to be encouraged to speak in those synagogues, letter after letter throughout the book of the New Testament, and it's just amazing to read through it, isn't it, guys? The New Testament, the letters.
Oh, yeah.
It's beautiful. Okay. So this is just one example of how Paul used his ministry for the work of God with what was familiar, but beyond that is in the ongoing proclamation of the goodness of God. It goes way, way beyond this. I'm not joking, really serious. I began to really read more past this to learn more about Paul. I have learned that in Acts chapter 18 and chapter 19, we're not going to read all those chapters. I don't want to be here till 2 o'clock. And because I talk about chapter 18 and 19 because I found in those books that there's just so many miracles. Throughout Acts, Paul and Timothy and Peter, he picks up people along the way. I mean, it's great to read through Acts because he finds people to join him to be able to lay hands on them, speak with authority in the name of Jesus, and people are healed in that instant level we've been speaking of. And so that's one reason why it goes way beyond. Then also in my preparation, I was led to read each of the greeting of each of the letters to the churches because I wanted to see more of the personhood of Paul to each of the churches that he had a heart for and led by God. And I will go through not each of them, but a couple of them. To give you a good illustration or paint a little picture for you on why he opened up with why he opened up to each church. Because I got something from each one that I read, because I'm thinking that with each church that he was called to speak to, with whatever synagogue that he was speaking at, God gave him something different for each one, because each one was in a different place. Just like if you're a counselor here and you have, every client's different, and every client on my caseload, me being a job coach, is different. So he had to adapt where they were at, as we do with our work. In Romans, we're going to start off with, we're going to do three epistles. Romans 1, verses 1 through 7. So, of course, each of these is going to start off with the first verse. And, you know, Romans is right after Acts. Everybody doing okay? Mm-hmm. All right, love it. This is great. I loved practicing this. From Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, who has been called to be an apostle and specially chosen to preach the good news that God promised long ago through his prophets and scriptures.
One more time, I'm sorry. Where are we? Chapter 7?
Romans 1.
Thank you.
No, Romans 1, verses 1 through 7.
Thank you.
Alrighty, here we go again. From Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, who has been called to be an apostle and specially chosen to preach the good news that God promised long ago through his prophets and the scriptures. This news is about the Son of God, who according to the human nature he took was a descendant of David. It is about Jesus Christ, our Lord, in the order of the Spirit of holiness that was in him was proclaimed Son of God and all his power through the resurrection from the dead. Through him, we received grace and our apostolic mission to preach the obedience of faith to all pagan nation, to all pagan nations in honor of his name. You are one of those nations, and by his call belong to Jesus Christ. To you all then who are God's beloved in Rome, called to be saints, may God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ send grace and peace. Send grace and peace. Just think for a moment what grace and peace does for you. Now, I again read this over and over, not because I was practicing, but because my spirit just loved. I wanted to rush to the ending to get to the grace and peace part, because God offers us so much grace and peace every single day that our spirits need to be reminded of. And as I also reflected on this, I noticed how much boldness and obedience that Paul had to be able to make such an address like this. But there's another paragraph that goes beyond this, which I'm choosing not to read for now, but we might choose later. But it goes on for like a Thanksgiving kind of prayer for the people to just hold them up, you know, in God's glory. And I just love that boldness about Paul, because we are also to be bold. I mean, I have a boldness about me, and sometimes it can either, again, work for or against me. But I want, and my prayer is to use my boldness in this example of Paul, the way he kind of addressed the Romans. So also in this, does anybody have any thoughts about that before we go on? You can. Okay. Speak now or forever. No. 1 Corinthians 1, verses 1 through 9. Y'all are making me thirsty.
What version are you reading from?
Ta-da-da, the Betty Bible. It is the New Jerusalem Bible.
That's what I've done.
There you go. Nice. And I also have stuff throughout here that I just took from, that I won't read out of here from my phone app, so. All right, here we go. 1 Corinthians 1, verses 1 through 9. I, Paul, appointed by God to be an apostle together with brother, help me out, Sonathesis, send greetings to the Church of God in Corinth, to the holy people of Jesus Christ, who are called to take their place among all the saints everywhere, who pray to our Lord Jesus Christ, for he is their Lord, no less than ours. May God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ send you grace and peace. Well, that sounds familiar too. And before I finish, if I can have your permission, the Holy Spirit is speaking with me, to me. I want to reveal in here where it says, everyone who prayed to our Lord Jesus Christ, I'm going to underline this. Cindy said just to me today, the teacher learns just as much as everyone else during the teaching. And I believe that right now. Mm-hmm.
our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, send you. Okay. So let's take this apart. This is something I recently learned. When you think of Lord, you think of back in the day of, back in this day, Lord is someone that you would answer to and that you highly respected and honored. And sometimes it was good, sometimes it wasn't, oh, well, okay. But you had that respect. And so I learned that, and kind of I had that well, okay kind of mindset and frame of thinking. And I struggled with that with my scripture reading throughout my life until recently it was revealed to me that in this context with in the Bible with God, it's actually a loving thing to be able to receive the Lord on such a personal level, and you will want to answer to him because you know that you are called in the relationship with God, Jesus Christ. So I want to encourage you guys to just also receive that or renew your spirit in that as we read this or in your own scripture reading time. I never stopped thinking, we're continuing on verse 4 now. I never stopped thanking God for all the graces you have received through Jesus Christ. I thank him that you have been enriched in so many ways, especially in your teachers and preachers. The witnesses to Christ has indeed been strong among you, so that you will not be without any of the gifts of the Spirit while you are waiting for our Lord Jesus Christ to be revealed. And he will keep you steady without a flame until the last day, the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Because God, by calling you, has joined you to his Son, Jesus Christ. And God is faithful. So these are great reminders in these last verses of 4 through 9. And I think they're great reminders because, you know, when we go through those dark days, when we go through days like, where is that grace and peace? We are encouraged by God of just what it proclaims right here. Is the just, I wish we could just reread it all night, because it says, Lord Jesus Christ to be revealed. He's revealed in us each and every day. And it says, I thank him that you have been enriched in so many ways, especially in your teachers and preachers. Now I want to sit on that, because here under this roof, we are surrounded by that all the time. We were just talking about intensive before the class began. And I don't know why. When I first started coming here, it's like, I'm going to intensive. And I'm like, okay. I don't know why I decided to do that when I was so broken and everything. But, you know, it's the Spirit that can receive. And I just got addicted and I got hooked. And here I am still doing this and praising God for that. And so the preachers and the teachers, we're all part of that. But I want you guys to also think of who it is in your life, what preachers and teachers or mentors in your life that really speak into you from God, because I know Paul speaks of that in ways that he was encouraged, because remember when, what was his name that came and laid hands on him and then he got baptized?
Ananias.
Yeah, Ananias. Thanks, Lily. And so that was one. That was like maybe the first one. I don't know. The first one, well, was Lord Jesus Christ. But we all have many. And we have to really give that credit to God and show our teachers, preachers, mentors our great appreciation for that. So he's
addressing them as I kind of just addressed you, showing you guys how he was addressing them. And also last one is in Galatians 1, 11 through 24. And I put this is so powerful because this shows how Paul illustrates to us and the church of Galatia of why and how his conversion happened. He goes to explain exactly how it happened. And excuse me, I think sometimes we need to tell our story. We need to say this happened because of this, and this is, I would love for this to happen. And when we disciple somebody or when we are doing apologetic evangelism, this kind of stuff helps. And I love it. This is kind of long, and I will read it. Glacia, give me time to turn there. 1, 11 through 24. Okay. Galatians 1, 11 through 24 is entitled God's Call. So he's talking about God's call to the church of Galatia in his life. The fact is, brothers, and I want you to realize this, the good news I have preached is not a human message that I was given by men. It is something I learned only through a revelation of Jesus Christ. You must have heard my career as a practicing Jew, how merciless I was in persecuting the church of God, how much damage I did to it, how much I stood out among Jews of my generation, and how enthusiastic I was for the traditions of my ancestors. Then God, who had specially chosen me while I was still in my mother's womb, called me through his grace and chose to reveal his son. We just read this. I'm reading it again. So that I might preach the good news about him to the pagans. I did not stop to discuss with any human being, nor did I go to Jerusalem and see those who were already apostles before me. But where did he go? Arabia. And why did he go to Arabia?
To seek the Lord.
So I don't really feel like I'm called to read the rest of that because we all kind of remember it in our spirits and we need to move on, keep going. But the key word I have key words I have taken from this with him addressing Galatia is that he was called for a purpose and he was chosen. And for purpose is I have taught before on in other Bible classes is that prophets were called by a purpose, as so each of us are also called for a purpose. As you know, I do quote Betty. She's very influential in my life. We are to be about our Father's business, and Paul knew that. Paul knew that he had the purpose of being about his Father's business, and God gave him the authority to do so because he was chosen by God for this assignment. And I know, and I relate to this all too well, that the struggle is real and a challenge to the core of my inner being on a daily basis. Even though I know that I have purpose, which is I must be about my Father's business, you know, I struggle. You know, we're human, we're flesh, and I'm sure that Paul knew about depression and anxiety and questioning his faith and only holding on to hope by a thread sometimes. So that's a good reminder in Scripture, which is reminding us also in 2 Corinthians. And this is 2 Corinthians 4, verse 9, which I was taken from the NLT, New Living Testament, which I've been now reading in my regular Bible reading. And I think we might have just read this too. And I think it's good that we're kind of repeating Scripture because I feel the more repetition and the more we repeat, the more it gets into our souls and spirits. So it's says we are hunted down, but never abandoned by God. We get knocked down, but we are not destroyed. I mean, some days I'll come home and I'm like, gosh, I feel so knocked down. I want to sleep on my couch, and I do, and I go to my bed, and I feel that way. But I know as I'm resting, God's holding me in the palm of my hand, his hand. And that helps my spirit be revived and renewed from his Holy Spirit. And so Paul was not only a man of God who knew what true repentance was, but he also got to obviously really know what real hardship was as well, unfortunately on a regular basis. No ordinary man was he, but a man of great ongoing strength. Some of these hardships were stoned and left for dead. People thought he was dead and he just lied there. And by the grace of God, he got up. And he went on with his assignment. And he was shipwrecked many times. Not once, but I believe many times. And much persecution that led to trial and prison. And as I read through this last bullet of those three that I mentioned, as I was reading through Acts, and even now in my 1 year Bible study, I'm ironically in Acts and learning a lot, and it's helped me prepare, is that he would go into these cities or community towns, and they would, at first they'd be, okay, let's see what this guy's about, but then they would turn things on him and chase after him and want to kill him and just throw him in prison all the time. So, yeah, he was persecuted a lot. But did that, cause him to give up? And it didn't. And that's what I admire about Paul. I do. I admire not only, tenacity is just not the word for it. It's the drive and the will to do God's will, I think, really. So right now I'd like to ask, the class, both online and here, if you've had any hardships that you've come through and that's led you to repentance, or that you know that you have received that grace and you have received that peace that God has led you through for whatever kind of inner turmoil or fury or outside circumstances. And yeah, go ahead and share. I open it up. Crystal, run around with that mic.
Tina, mm-hmm. I want to share something, and you're doing so great. Thank you for your teaching tonight. But what I love that I'm hearing you say tonight is that even when Paul faced these adversities, he stayed with the plan of where God was calling him. And I know for my own walk, it's like you go down that path, you feel God calling you to, and then you deal with these things, and it's easy to want to get off the path. And what Paul is showing us is if we continue on the path, God has a plan for us that far outweighs anything we could even imagine. And that's what I like, is Paul's writing to these churches and telling them of his experiences. But like you said, he stayed on it, even through the pain. And I think for me, my natural response is to want to run. But we have to keep our eye on where God is calling us for his works, because he has bigger plans for us than we can even think of. So thanks for that reminder tonight.
You bet. Thank you.
This is Matisse. And I had, as you were talking, I had an interesting interaction this week. And so my church did a testimony. Like they recorded my testimony, and it ended up being, I don't know, like 30 minutes long. It's really long. And I felt kind of funny about it, but anyway, it happened almost a year ago, and they have it on their website. And so I had mentioned anyway, that this one of, Michael's scout troop leaders, I was talking to him and he knew what church I went to. And so he went and looked at the church and then he's like, I saw your testimony on there, and he listened to it. And, for me, it was an interesting thing because, just that night, like a few minutes after that, I had a scuffle with Michael and I had to gently restrain Michael and then remove him from the scout troop. And I think that there was like, first off, it's humbling to have somebody, you know, I talk in there about my drug addiction and the struggles that I had, you know, coming here and fighting through that. And I think that, you know, there, when he mentioned it, it's kind of humbling just to have somebody you that I'm sitting and talking to that I haven't had that discussion with, and that isn't in that frame. But he's actually a pastor of a Lutheran church, and he told me that that touched his life. And I know this is turning out to be a longer, my brain isn't working fully today, but I feel like there was something in that about being reminded of God's goodness and grace by even remembering my own story, because I think that today the struggle and adversity are, you know, it's so much in my face that it's hard to remember sometimes that God has already been faithful. He's already done these things. He's already shown himself to me in these ways. And so I feel like, you know, not to talk about myself, but even someone reminding me about my own testimony was like God talking to me about his faithfulness and just reminding me that story isn't, you know, that brokenness can be used, and he found it encouragement. Not everyone has lived the life that I have lived. Mm-hmm. And if that can be used to teach other people faithfulness, that is good. But for me in that moment, it just was a funny little wave of the events. I apologize if that didn't make a lot of sense, but to me, there was just a connection with your teaching about adversity and going through and just staying faithful to God, and Paul holding on to that is just a beautiful thing. And it's a good reminder for me. Tina, you are doing a great job. I really appreciate you taking the time to teach tonight and all the studying you did.
Yeah, thank you, Matisse. That was fitting. And I appreciate that reflection and processing and sharing with all of us a piece of your beautiful testimony that you were encouraged by the Holy Spirit to keep going on. And yes. Anybody else before we go on?
Yeah.
Okay. Nick wants to talk.
Yeah. I'm a little cautious about bringing it up. I keep feeling like this was neat, but it's been 53 years. Do you have something fresher? Well, maybe I do, maybe I don't. Some of you have heard my testimony of coming to the Lord. I'll try and give you the short version, because to me, only the Apostle Paul is somebody that I've heard from that has had such an instant attitude adjustment, kind of like the country western song. There's a country western song about attitude adjustment. Look it up. It's pretty good. And that's kind of what I picked up from what Kathy Fulmer first said was about the way I took it. Was attitude adjustment. And this really is a short version. Spring of 70, I was homicidal and suicidal. If it wasn't for the Lord, you would know of me as a guy that shot up downtown Portland. I was taking anthropology at Portland State University, And we had the school was on strike, and we could have our class if we would discuss the situation around. And the kind of the main provocation to everybody was that we were illegally bombing Cambodia during the Vietnam War. So this is why the schools were on strike. So I'm in my anthropology class in Old Main Auditorium, and I had decided I am going to sit here until I know what is going on. And I heard like a voice behind me, but I didn't turn around to look. I heard, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me." Mm-hmm. And I said, "Yes, Lord." Mm. And I immediately raised my hand and stood up. And I told the class of about 300 people that I had had 3 years of anthropology, and I had listened to many of them, like the professor of the class. He looked more like me than my dad or anybody in my family. I mean, he looked like me plus 20 years. And there was a very close friend's mom in the class, and she actually had gotten up on the stage and was saying that she grew up through World War II and the Depression, that the world was not handed to her generation on a silver platter either. Mm. And there were the student radicals and all these others getting up, various people foaming at the mouth and whatever. And I just said, "I have listened to all of you, studied anthropology for 3 years, and whatever man has developed has turned rotten on him. And Jesus Christ has kept every promise he ever made. And with that record, I don't know about you, but I am going to follow Jesus. I am not going to follow man." Mm-hmm. And I picked up my books to leave, and they decided that was the end of the meeting. There were people all the way around me. They were behind me, beside me, in front of me, and they're saying, "Wow, we have never heard it like this. Where do you go to church?" And I said, I have not been to church for many years. I just learned this right here. And I don't think I have heard of anybody but the Apostle Paul have such an attitude adjustment that there was, I could go on and on about changes, but I don't know that anything came of my speaking to them. Mm. I didn't ever have anybody come back to me and say, "You're that guy," or whatever. And I have kind of headed up some hippy trippy sorts of ministries and so forth. And really, you know, really haven't discipled anybody, anything like that. And I can only think of one instance that I saw somebody from Madras, where we had a ministry, and they were thrilled to see me, and they said, "You know, there's still fruit from that ministry." Mm. And I'm just kind of, And they said, fruit that remains. But that's about all I've seen or heard. I do keep praying for folks. My neighbor Larry, just down the hill here, just died in the last day or so. And severe alcoholic and so forth. I got together with him and prayed last summer. So hope to see him again. Mm-hmm. Not terribly soon, but sometime.
Well, thank you, Nick. And this really added to the class as well, everybody that's spoken thus far. And Nick, I see that testimony, even though I've heard it before. It's always great hearing testimonies over and over, because it, every time you hear a testimony, it resonates within your soul and encourages your spirit to spread the word of God. And Nick, that I feel is great boldness, and that's what we've been talking about tonight, is boldness that Paul had. So also in Romans, we're going to move on to another one. Now back to Romans, we've been in that a few times tonight. Paul states in chapter 7 in Romans, verses 21 through 23.
I'm sorry, did you say chapter 1?
Nope, I said chapter 7, verses 21 through 23.
Romans?
Yep, Romans. And I didn't mark that, but I'm going to try to read it anyway. 21 through 23. Let everyone stay as he was at the time of his call. If, when you were called, you were a slave, do not let this bother you, but if you should have the chance of being free, accept it. A slave, when he was called in the Lord, becomes the Lord's freed man, and a free man called in the Lord becomes Christ's slave. Well, I'm kind of processing right now, and Spirit is speaking to me, and I'm thinking it's saying that when you're called by the Lord, by, let's say, an assignment, and you have this lifestyle, as Paul did, as when he went by Saul to persecute, and he was kind of a slave to that. And he wasn't free in Christ yet. But when we break our bondage of our, before we come to repentance, that process of going through is a chance for us to become, that, like it says, the freed man. So in a sense, you see Paul becoming, as he's teaching, like I said, as we teach, we learn, he's becoming a free man. Instead of a slave to the wrong kind of thing, he's now becoming a slave in a more positive way as a free man. Then it goes on to say, I don't think I marked it, but I do believe it's important. It says, although I want to do good, evil is right there with me. So I don't have scripture for this. You all know this, probably know where it's at. For in my inner being, I delight in God's law. In my inner being, I delight in God's law. But I see another law work in me, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within me. And we know this all too well. And what is it called? It's called spiritual warfare, yes. And so many things can cause it. It's not of God. It's from the enemy, the evil one, however you want to say it. But try not, we don't want to give life to it. But for me, it can look like anger, which has four things beneath it, and I kind of play into that with mostly fear and shame. And then that creates the pain, which plays into the guilt. And then I have to repent. So that's, a lot of fun stuff. And we have a question or an addition.
The verse that you were looking for is in Romans 7:15.
Okay, it's Romans 7, verse 15.
I do not do what I want to do.
Yes. Thank you. Crystal looked that up for us. And so I didn't have that down. So Romans, what again, Crystal?
Romans 7:15.
Romans 7:15. Let's just read it again. See, I want you to sit quietly in your spirit with God and think about this. Although I want to do good, I want to do good. But evil is right there with me. For my inner being, I delight in God's law. But I see another law at work in me, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within me. And this is a battle I've been battling this past year. Of just wanting to have more and more inner healing, and it's huge process with me in my life, and it's hard to be patient, but I'm having, God's blessed me with such a great support system. So I want to pose the question now to the class. If they got God with your inner being tested with this stuff, you want to do good with this, but spiritual warfare is around every corner. Can you name at least one instance that you just really want to do good, but dang it, this is really hounding me today with this shame or with this or that? So I just want to open it up for a little bit. Okay.
I think in
Lily. Yeah, Lily wants to talk, Crystal.
I believe in spiritual warfare, that when we're in this battle with the flesh and knowing what is right to do, but that you're struggling. My experience has been that if I am trying to do the right thing, if I want to do the right thing, that God will come to my defense. And he gives me that power to maintain and overcome.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
But sometimes that will come through the word. That conviction will also come through the word.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Very true.
But with him, we are victorious.
Amen. So I don't know if this is fitting with the teaching. This is what I got when I was preparing and processing this. Also, you can see a parallelism. I was just also in my yearly Bible study. I've learned a lot about David, and I'm learning about Paul. And both men are men of God, wanting to listen to God. And as I am in both Samuel and Acts, most recently, I see both men going to God, asking what to do next. And this reminds me of both Paul and David running for safety as they seek God's will and battle that spiritual warfare at the same time, feeling defeated. Now, I think it was Veronica, who was saying she just wants to run sometimes, and I of course, I feel that way. Can't speak for all of you. Yeah, I definitely feel that way. And we see here that they both did. But then in that running, we seek the Lord. And that's a great reminder. If you read those scriptures throughout the New Testament of how Paul sought the Lord in prison. You know, he sang praises to the Lord in prison. He wrote. You know, and a lot of times in our journaling time or our devotionals, we write and we worship. And that's exactly what Paul did. So we all get second chances and even big assignments from God. And that is what Paul encountered with God. It's indeed a huge assignment, huge encounter, and a huge assignment right away even. This is where repentance had to happen fast and literally in an instant, as we have said many times during this teaching. I find it truly amazing how God can change one man and can reach so many others through the sovereignty of God. You know, it's God's sovereignty. It's God's grace. It's not our own. I know Paul did not have this planned. He was just going along on his horse as Saul. I'm going to go persecute some people and maybe kill a few. So, yeah, he did not have this planned. So, kind of switching gears here, but not really. We hear Saul. We hear Paul. Well, who is it? You know, what's his name? Did he, during his conversion, did God say, hey, you're not Saul anymore, you're Paul? Well, as I was reading through here, I saw Saul and I saw Paul, but I knew it was the same person. But I always thought in my life, did his name change? And so me being one of my strengths, the love of learning and curiosity, I had to look it up. And right now, I would like Veronica to just play a little video for us explaining that. Hey, Veronica, it's time for the video now.
Sorry, I'm doing it now.
Okay, you bet. I'm going to sit down for a bit. This might answer some questions.
Today's question is, when and why was Saul's name changed to Paul? In this video, I'll answer that question from a biblical perspective. Then afterwards, as always, I'll share some helpful resources, so stick around to the end. One of the often thought of name changes in the Bible is that of Saul to Paul. The change is commonly linked to Saul's conversion on the Damascus Road, when the Lord Jesus commissioned him to take the gospel to the Gentiles. However, at the time of Saul's conversion, Jesus still addressed him as Saul. Later, Jesus told Ananias to find Saul in Damascus and restore his sight. Acts chapter 9 goes on to describe Saul as increasing in spiritual strength and understanding of Jesus as the Messiah. So, it was not Jesus who changed his name on the road to Damascus. If it wasn't Jesus' doing, how did the change from Saul to Paul happen, and when? The answer is that Saul's name was also Paul. The custom of dual names was common in those days. Acts chapter 13, verse 9 describes the apostle as Saul, who was also called Paul. From that verse on, Saul is always referred to in Scripture as Paul. Paul was a Jew born in the Roman city of Tarsus. He was proud of his Jewish heritage, as he describes in Philippians chapter 3, verse 5. Circumcised on the eighth day, of the race of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrew parentage, in observance of the law of Pharisee. So zealous and devout was he that persecuting Christians was the natural way for him to show his devotion. He chose to use his Hebrew name, Saul, until sometime after he began to believe in and preach Christ. And after that time, as the apostle to the Gentiles, he used his Roman name, Paul. It would make sense for Paul to use his Roman name as he traveled further and further into the Gentile world. It is interesting that Paul began using his Roman name on Cyprus when the Roman proconsul on that island was converted. This was during Paul's first missionary journey and involved a high-ranking idolatrous Gentile coming to faith in Christ. The fact that the proconsul's name was Sergius Paulus had led some to think that Saul took the name Paulus or Paul as a reminder of this event, but the apostle's name being the same as the proconsul's is most likely a coincidence. Using his Roman name was fitting for the man who proclaimed that he would become all things to all people, a Jew to the Jews in order to win the Jews, weak to the weak in order to win the weak, etc. All for the sake of the gospel, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 19 through 23. Adopting his Roman name would also allow Paul to approach the Gentiles to whom he was sent and speak to them in their own language, becoming as one of them and setting them at ease. It is also possible that Paul gave up the use of his Hebrew name, Saul, with its regal connotation, and chose to use his Roman name, Paul, meaning little or small, because he desired to become smaller in order to present Christ as greater. Unlike the changing of Simon's name to Peter, which Jesus did for a specific purpose, there is no reference in the Bible to Jesus' changing Saul's name to Paul. Want to learn more? Subscribe so you don't miss the next video. Visit gotquestions.org for more great content and check out the details section below this video. There's one book I recommend along with several related questions. If you'd like to learn about Bible Munch or if you're interested in bite-sized devotionals, subscribe to Bible Munch on YouTube. It's linked right here. Now remember, got questions? The Bible has answers and we'll help you find them.
Okie doke. So, name change or not to name change? I've chose to keep with Tina. Not really. So, but that was Paul, and this is me. But he had dual names. We learned, and that was fine. And I understand why he may have wanted to, you know, go by his name Paul, because people knew him as Saul the persecutor. Maybe he felt protected, and people felt safe that way with this new Paul. We find in scripture a lot of these things that this gentleman brought up. And in conclusion of my teaching, you're probably waiting for a conclusion. You've been sitting here for a while, but really there's no conclusion but this white sheet of paper. You know, the printer spits out a white sheet of paper instead of conclusion. What happened with that? You know, so you guys know what the white sheet of paper is. It's grace and peace towards others. It's forgiveness. We've all had that lesson. Many, well, I can't speak, you know, many of us have. You know, we've heard the Betty lesson of the white sheet of paper. And I believe that's a lot of what this teaching is that the Lord spoke to me to teach is Paul learned. He learned what the white sheet of paper was. I had to give the white sheet of paper to two people in my life yesterday, today, and you know what? It's being kind of in my face, but in a good way. I'm not Paul by any means or Saul, but we are to give the white sheet of paper with our assignments from God, big, small, huge, whatever size. And we are the conclusion. We are not in conclusion, but we are an ongoing conclusion as we build the kingdom of God until Christ comes again or before we go home to him. Thank you so much.
Great job, Tina.
Excellent.
Excellent. Wow, good job.
about Tina. I'd like to just hear any feedback people would like to share, what their takeaway from this session was. What little nuggets?
Linda? I love the white sheet of paper. Conclusion is beautiful. That was just so
great conclusion.
Yes, it was.
Yeah.
Yeah, great conclusion. Anyone else have something they'd like to share with Tina? A little nugget of something you picked up tonight?
I like the question asking and waiting for answers. I appreciate that, Tina, that you seemed a little uncomfortable with the time, but I really appreciate that you took the time to ask questions and then pause and give us a chance to answer.
I'm just going to come back up here because I want to engage with you guys as you're debriefing here.
Mm-hmm.
Can I sit down? My feet are bugging me.
So, Tina.
Yes, Dorothea. Come on.
I've known you, and I've heard your teaching for some time. But you have matured in your teaching,
yeah.
And the encouragement that Betty gave us was, when we teach, is relationship, content, and timing.
Mm-hmm.
And you are learning that lesson well.
Thank you, Mary.
Yeah, you're engaging with, even with those that are online. And you're engaging with your life. I love that.
Mm.
I love that you're engaging with your life, even if you don't understand it or don't get it, you're still engaging.
No, I don't understand it. Shoot.
Shoot.
I want to say something else, but I can't. Thank you, Dorothea.
Yeah, I'm just thrilled. I'm just sitting here and let you, and you're just teaching, and I'm just taking it all in. It's just great job, great job.
And I've really enjoyed it tonight. I don't know. It just seems like the first time I've been up here, but I've been up here year after year, and for some reason it just seems like the first time I've been up here, but it hasn't been. I've really soaked it in.
Yeah. You learned with us, didn't you?
I did.
That's great. I loved it.
You seemed comfortable tonight. Did you feel comfortable?
Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm.
And I gave the Lord the desires of my heart in Cindy's office and in the car on the way over here with Crystal and me driving home earlier. It's just I was with the Lord, like I had said, and I gave him the desires of my heart. Is I want to be present, I want to learn, be open. My heart was just speaking to God. I mean, scripture says it groans and says stuff that we can't say. So it was giving to the Lord the desires of my heart, and I wanted more than anything to be able to be comfortable and to, yeah, exactly. And God answered prayer. Praise be to God.
I really liked your use of questions also, because questions make us just think deeply.
Mm-hmm.
They make us have to answer something that we're going to ponder deeply inside. And I think your use of questions was really good.
Mm, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I certainly, I used to be afraid of people asking me questions. And now that with some of the support that I am getting in my life, with living at home and friends in my life, it's helping. I am better understanding why people ask questions, is for both the receiver and the question person.
Person asking.
Mm-hmm. Nick took his mute off. I think he's trying to speak.
Yeah. I appreciated where you compared David and Paul. That, what I picked up from that, and I didn't really pick it up until after I kind of wrote down my version of it, but they did not feel victorious. Mm. So what do you counselor types know about feelings?
Know about what?
Feelings.
Can I answer? Because I'm going through that right now. I definitely having spiritual warfare over that right now. For a long period of time, a lifetime, and right now I have personally chosen to go deeper and to know that there's a difference between truth and feelings. And I used to feel that that feelings were the truth because the feelings became my truth for so long. And so you really have to, I'm learning that you have to say, okay, here are the feelings, here's the truth. And sometimes it's like, you know, a centrifuge to where everything's jiggling. And then you have to decipher, okay, he or she loves me. They're not trying to reject me. That's the truth. And that's, you know, I may feel that way, but then you ask God, okay, you know, you just kind of have conversations like that. You've got to. I'm not really 100% there yet because, as I said, I'm just now going through this process, you know, on a more concrete way.
I sometime just earlier in the last year or so, somebody could have been on the preacher on the radio in the car or something. The point was that feelings are real, but they are not true. That's something that you have to work through. That's part of the bringing every thought captive to Christ. That, you know, just because you got a thought in your head doesn't mean it's right.
Yeah. And
Elsa, I want to hear from Elsa Jane.
You're being picked on, Elsa Jane.
I think she's muted.
Oh, you're muted, Elsa Jane. You're still muted, huh?
Maybe she's not.
Can Veronica take her off? Or?
No, she doesn't take herself off.
She's talking.
Yeah.
We can't hear you, Elsa Jane.
Can't hear you.
Okay.
Oh, there you go.
There you go. I'm not very good with these buttons, you know. Here's what I saw through the whole thing, Tina. You did a really good job of helping us get acquainted with the man, Paul. And what I noticed was that God took all of the strengths of Saul and turned them toward his purposes. So that Saul, in his zealousness for the Torah, became a man who was zealous for the Lord.
Ooh.
In Judaism, there is a famous concept called the turning. And when man turns from man toward God, and I believe that all the miracles that Jesus did that are in the Gospels and the ones that the disciples did or the apostles did in Acts are all about turning mankind toward God. So that from that day on, they see things from the Father's perspective. So when Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life," he was literally describing living from that turned place, where you do not look at the world from the perspective of the world and the flesh, but you look at the world from God's perspective. And then God's promises, then we have eyes to see and ears to hear God's promises bearing fruit. And until we turn, we're blind and we're deaf. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We're not mute, that's for sure. but we do not speak truth.
Yeah.
We speak our perspective of truth, which is powerless to change anything.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So until we speak his truth, mm-hmm. no power and authority to create new life in it.
Well, all of a sudden we can't.
All of a sudden we lost you, Elsa Jane.
We lost you, Elsa Jane.
How did you lose me?
There we go. We can hear you now.
There you are.
It's them both. Okay. Yeah.
So when Jesus said, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" The light bulb went on in Saul. The inner light went, persecute? And he turned to come to an understanding of how was he persecuting. So that was the beginning. That why do you persecute me? Remember in Genesis when God came into the garden after they'd eaten the apple and he said,
"Where are you?
Where are you? And what have you done?" When God asks the question, man, we're done for. Mm-hmm. Because that's when we turn, because we're going to get his perspective, not ours or somebody else's.
Wow, yeah. Really good.
That is good. Thank you.
And that's what I was gaining. I want you to know, Tina, I was gaining a perspective of Paul that I'd never had before. So thank you.
You're welcome. And that's one reason why I was called to receive this message, to give this message. Every year something said, do this, and it never goes away. And sometimes I get it instantly, as we've spoken about. And the way the Lord showed me how to present this is not, oh, how smart Paul was, his huge history of this complexity of who he was, because there's a lot involved with who he is. And I didn't want this to be a theological law thing. I wanted it to be relational. I wanted to see the personhood of Paul.
And you can see that Paul went from Torah, religion, to relationship. That was the conversion.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't about what he knew. It was about what God knew about him, what the Lord knew about him. And from that time on, Torah was totally different.
And he saw that God saw him.
Yes. It was a major, major change inside him.
Mm-hmm.
When it's that big, you have to go away alone.
Yeah, and that's what I said in the teaching as well.
Work it out. Yeah, that was a wonderful point.
Yeah. Okay, we have someone in the audience.
I just want to say two things. I really appreciate how you did it. I feel like you did a full encompassing story of Saul, Paul.
Mm.
And not only did you hit that at the end, the Saul, Paul difference, because some of us were asking.
Mm-hmm.
Well, did Jesus give him that name? How did he go from Saul? You saw that ahead of time, which was great. And I appreciate that you showed the full story of him, his repentance, and his, after that, he sat for 3 years in isolation. You asked, how would that feel?
Yeah.
That hit me, because I'm like, how, we couldn't do that.
Mm-hmm.
That would be, how would you do that? How did he do that?
I have a hard enough time having my quiet time with God.
So thank you, you did great.
Yeah. You're welcome.
I just want to say I really delight in watching you, Tina. Mm. You're so present. Yeah. And just your confidence.
Sure.
And how calm you are.
Yeah.
And a great message. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Call it good.
Shall we?
All right.
All right. Well, shall we pray?
Yes.
It's been a good evening. Father, we just want to give you such praise and thanks for our dear sister Tina and the depth that you're putting into her being, how she's growing up in you, God, as we all are, because we all desire to be like you. And so I thank you for what she's offered tonight. And we ask, Lord God, that you'd go with each one of us and help us to remember things we've learned and to just think about those things in a really deep way. We give thanks for everyone who's come tonight. And we ask that you deliver them home safely and bring them back next week safely so that, Father God, we can continue the deep teaching that goes on in this place. We just give you thanks for all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right.